Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
This is your girl Yannick Taylor, aka Priestess, hostess of Conversations with the Priestess. Here's a preview of what you may hear on Conversations with the Priestess.
We weren't meant for monogamy, let's be honest. Like, we have needs, let's be real. And communicating that, what you want, what you don't want, what sets up.
Now, this drink is brown, because I learned something. Since I'm older, I can't do brown liquor anymore. Also, I noticed since I started on hormone replacement therapy, HRT, in 2015, me and certain liquors don't mix well. I don't know whether...
And I recognize that a lot of men love to be dominated by women. And that's because men are seen as these leaders, as this big alpha male dominant being. And because they're put on this pedestal of being leaders, sometimes they want to be submissive. Back when I cosplayed a butch queen in South Carolina around 2011, I was on Craigslist. This is when Craigslist was bumping and before they had gotten rid of the personal section. I hope you enjoyed that preview. Join me on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. for Priestess After Dark. Full video versions of the podcast can be found on patreon.com/CWTPriestess and join me on Fridays at noon for our regular Friday post. Live, love, and be free. Smooches.
Available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you download and stream podcasts.
Age of Radio.
Jason,
Brandon,
you gotta get. Oh no! Oh, you know what? I just realized something.
What's that?
Okay, Jason, you're Jason, right? What's your wife's name?
Katrina.
Okay. We talked about a movie last week, and you know what tends to happen around this time. So, but everything's good. You got a guest lined up? Or?
I tried. Very difficult.
Okay,
it was very difficult this week to get a guest, and they're all busy.
Uh-huh.
Because there's a festival going on in Republican Heaven, but I won't talk more about it because it's quite hush-hush. But I did have something to tell you, Brendan.
Oh, no. What?
I've gathered you here today, all of you.
Okay, you're talking to our audience. That is very quiet throughout our podcast.
To reveal to you, my podcast partner, Brendan, yes. That...
Son of a bitch!
It's me again.
Oh!
It's I, Daniel Day-Lewis.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
My greatest performance ever was coming on this podcast. And impersonating you unimportant people.
Now, Jason.
That's
Daniel.
Not my name. My name
Daniel.
Is Daniel.
Maybe your name is Daniel.
No.
You know, it's come to the point now where I expect this.
Yes,
after
well,
a Daniel Day-Lewis film is discussed.
I have proven it time and time again of my capabilities as an actor.
And listen, I've spent a lot of time thinking about it.
Mm.
And I just I want to let you know that... Hello.
What a twist!
It's also me, Daniel Day-Lewis.
How is this even possible?
I've been doing an impression of both of you.
This is amazing.
And myself.
There's two of me.
I'm talking to another person in the room.
Is this like multiplicity?
It's a much classier version.
Oh, multiplicity. Yes, of course. This is the sort of version that might win us an Academy Award.
Well, oh.
How would I act as myself?
Wait a second, Daniel.
Daniel.
I've got an idea.
Yes.
Let's do this multiplicity.
Yeah.
But we are two Daniels.
Oh.
We will win all of the Academy Awards.
They would have to nominate us for both Best Actor and Best Supporting Actor.
Yes, do all the cocaine.
Ooh.
As we do. We are both massive cokeheads.
Yes, well, and that would be part of getting into the role of us.
Yes. So why don't we go and do that? We'll let these boys out of the closet.
Yes.
And we can go make Multiplicity 2021.
So what you're saying is we'll let them out of the closet in a way they themselves can't do.
Ah!
Yes, acting. Gay joke.
Well... Let's take our jetpacks.
I'm going to set a timer on the lock and we can just get out of here before they get out.
Okay. Oh, look, I found a bunch of dead people's jetpacks.
Nice.
Beep, beep.
It's so hot in there.
Jesus.
Oh, you sweat so much, Brendan.
No. Well, you didn't have to put your tongue on it.
Well, I mean, I was thirsty.
Oh, Jesus.
God, it was so hot. Wait, what happened?
Wait, is this a podcast?
I mean, the mics are set up, and I now have a pair of headphones on for some reason, so.
Hold on, Jason. It says play this song if you're confused, and everything will be answered. Let's try this.
Okay.
Oh, so that's what we've been doing.
Yeah, they must have replaced us again.
Oh, Double Day-Lewis is what they call it.
I don't know how that's possible.
I don't know. Jason, I'm just glad we've read up on the history of this podcast that the Day-Lewises have started.
Yeah.
And now we know how it runs and what our opinions would be. And I got to say, again, I mean, I think I've said this before. I don't know.
Yeah.
But our opinions run precisely to theirs.
Wow. Wow. My mind is blown. Oh,
but
man.
Your body's telling you yes.
Oh, God.
Oh,
oh man. Oh, God.
Oh, man. Oh, God. Thank you, Mr. O'Neill.
Thank you.
Jason, this is a podcast.
It continues to be a podcast.
We talk about British film on this podcast. And this podcast is called For Screen
and Country.
And by British film, let me get a little specific for you. Let me break it down for you, baby. Oh, yeah.
You tell him, Brendan.
Oh, let me tell you what we talk about. I say we talk about British film, but what I'm really saying is that we talk about the British Film Institute's top 100 British films of all British time.
And as a bone to throw to our Irish fans, yes, we get it. You're not part of England, but you're considered English adjacent enough to be on this list occasionally.
Stop calling yourself English Jason.
it's my Western character friend. That was I was actually cut out of Unforgiven when I was 9.
Yeah, the name. It wasn't the fact that you were 9, though. They just said the name was.
Well, they had English Bob already, and to have English Jason as a sidekick, they thought that was a bit much.
Right.
Yeah, but Clint Eastwood was a nice guy. We played a lot of Nintendo together.
So, Jason, we are talking about a movie off the list this week, of course. This is our 90th movie.
Ah, on yes. The BFI our Top 90th 100. Movie, and I believe the only, not really a remake, but the only version of the same story on this
only
list?
Only second version of the same, yeah. No, yeah. A different version of the same story of a movie of another movie on the list, for sure. But before we talk about that particular film, we need to read some comments regarding the movie we talked about last week, which was, of course,
I think it was My Beautiful Laundrette, but the Day-Lewises might have watched that one.
Well, we'll try to make sense.
Well, we'll just roll with it.
And now we go into the pre-recorded section of the episode, because Jason is on vacation as I record this, as I read your comments about My Beautiful Laundrette. Unfortunately, yeah, Jason is away. He did give me a little bit of insight, though, to let you know in his absence. I do have a quote here from him. He said, much like George Carlin said about God, I love you, but I need your money. So there you have it. I'm going to get into some comments here about My Beautiful Laundrette, which is the movie we talked about last week. All right, so our first comment here comes from Andy Utech, and he says, I don't think of it as a great film, but I do think of it as important. I imagine it might be both to some viewers. It certainly opened my eyes to experiences I had no awareness of. Yeah, and I think the way it deals with it is, I think I mentioned that last week, but the way it deals with it is very unique too, because I don't think it deals with it in a way that we expect like a Hollywood movie to deal with. You know, with gay characters, certainly not in 1985. That's insane the way it does. Our next comment comes from Sharon Horwat, and Sharon has seen this movie. So, catchphrase not in full swing this week. But she does say a number of things about this movie. I actually watched this back in college for an LGBTQ film studies class, and I actually had to write a paper on this one, so the reveal was not a surprise to me. I also watched this in college, Sharon, and but it was not for specifically for LGBTQ film studies, so the reveal did catch me off guard. Looking through Stephen Frears' IMDb page, and it seems like the only movie of his I feel any strong opinions on is High Fidelity, which I do like, and is another dad movie that I've watched several times. Thanks, Dad. High Fidelity, great film. Agreed. 100%. Jack Black's maybe his best performance in any movie. She also says, I cannot believe Hussein told someone that he thinks his son's penis wasn't working properly because he wasn't married yet. I want to scream. I mean, Sharon, at least you didn't have to see a bunch of penises in this one. I'll say that. So that was good. I love how when Omar sees Johnny again, Omar is totally smitten and just so happy to see him again, despite being harassed by the gang. I like that too. And you don't really catch on to that at first if you don't know what's coming. You're just kind of like, oh, they're buddies. Okay. All these close-ups of feet make me want to vomit. Yeah, there was some toenail clipping I wasn't a huge fan of. This montage in the club has some of the most 80s music I've ever heard. Me seeing Tanya and Rachel leaving Uncle Nasser. Good for her. And then Sharon closes it off by saying, overall, I like this movie a bit more than I did the first time I watched it, but I'm still kind of met on it. I think all of the individual elements are good, especially Johnny and Omar's relationship. They have amazing chemistry, but it doesn't feel like everything meshes together. Okay, well, that's a fair take. I mean, I do really, really like this movie, but I can see how maybe it doesn't fly as well for everyone. That's fine. Sharon, we love you, and please keep coming back every week. We love to hear from you. Victoria Stewart says, I really liked this movie at the time, and while I knew what was going to happen, I love how it played out. Stephen Frears directed two of my favorite movies of the late 1980s and 90s, Dangerous Liaisons and The Grifters, and then The Queen and High Fidelity were also terrific. I think he's especially a great director of actors, giving a lot of actors a career high. Yeah, I haven't seen most of those movies you mentioned, but all of which I have looked at and wanted to see, especially The Grifters. That's something I've wanted to see for a while. Julian Oldham, repeat commenter. Actually, I think everybody's been a repeat commenter so far. But Julian Oldham says, I'm a fan. It's funny and charming enough for me to overlook most of the flaws, especially given the Daniel Day-Lewis of it all. Love the casual approach to homosexuality, no death, no AIDS mentions that I recall, and the way race relations are treated. From everything I've heard about 80s Britain, it seems pretty on the money, and it reminds me more than a bit of post-Brexit social divides, too. I'm curious about whether it works as well for an international audience. Yeah, well, I would think that, I don't think it did. I think that's why it was, its success, I think, was more limited to the UK. But I think, I don't know, Julian, I think people would really dig this movie. I think more people saw it, I think it would have a bigger reputation, a better reputation. Certainly, it has a great reputation. You know what I mean? I mean, more people would like it. The reputation would be on a bigger scale. Maybe that's the word I'm looking for. Chad Freyd says, after watching Last of the Mohicans in 1992, I went into the filmography of Daniel Day-Lewis. Oh, Chad, be careful. He could replace you or someone you love. I learned that he had major range. In 1986, he did Laundrette, where he was vastly different from Cecil in A Room with a View. And then he was Tomas in The Unbearable Lightness of Being. By the time I got to My Left Foot, I realized he was one of the best actors ever. No wonder he has 3 Oscars. Yeah, he is. History's greatest monster, but yes, one of the greatest actors of all time, for sure. And that is all the comments that we have here about My Beautiful Laundrette. Now, we do have the final thing that we do before we move on to the episode. We compare this movie to the, since this is the BFI Top 100, and this movie was number 50, right in the middle, we compare it to the movie that rests at number 50 on the AFI Top 100, which is, of course, Lord of the Rings, The Fellowship of the Ring. And I did ask Jason beforehand, going into this, because I knew he wasn't going to be here, which one he preferred. And he told me that Lord of the Rings, The Fellowship of the Ring is his winner, but only by a pubic hair. And I would, imagery aside, I think I would agree. I think it's tough because My Beautiful Laundrette, and I know I talked about how much I love this movie, and I know Jason did too. But this always happens. It always comes up head to head with an American movie that I just like. It's Lord of the Rings is one of my favorite movies. And I don't know how Jason feels in regards to that. I'm sure he really loves it too, if he loves it more than this. But I can't say My Beautiful Laundrette is better than one of my favorite movies ever. So I have to give it to Lord of the Rings as well. Although just like Jason, it is a hair away. I won't specify what part of the body that hair emanates from, but a hair away. And that is going to do it, folks. We are going to move on. We are going to talk about this week's movie, which is, of course, the classic musical from the 60s, Oliver. Yes, that's right. Very jaunty, and I know Jason enjoyed, and you unfortunately you didn't get to see it, but I was animated that whole time.
He was conducting, you might say.
Conducting, very much like Kill the Wabbit style.
Yes.
Yeah, that music can only mean one thing, Jason.
Can it?
Well, no, I guess not.
It can mean a lot of different things.
But this week it means we're talking about Oliver!
Exclamation
mark,
point.
The second movie on this list that with an exclamation mark, by the way. The other, of course, being Whiskey Galore.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. We did a good 30 minutes on
and also,
movies ending with exclamation marks, so we don't need to dive back into that rabbit hole.
Did I know where I'm going in with an exclamation point? I know it's not on the list, but we did it.
It did, okay. But it's not on the list.
All right.
I mean, three exclamation mark movies is crazy.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
Like, two is pushing it. That's like putting seven David Lean movies on a list.
Ooh.
That's whoa, let's slow down.
It feels dangerous, and I like it.
I'm a little hard. but yeah, we talk about Oliver. This was made in 1968. This is number 77 on the list. And Jason, what is unique about this movie is that this almost feels like this could be an episode of And Now for Something Completely Similar, in which we look at movies that are like sequels or other adaptations or remakes of movies on the list, because we talked about Oliver Twist,
yeah,
the David Lean
we
film.
We did.
And this is Oliver, which is a musical version of the Dickens tale.
Hmm.
And it's, I mean, not a lot different in terms of the plot.
No.
You know, there's music, but I mean, ultimately it's the same story. It's the Dickens story.
And it's funny that of all the great British stories that have been told and told on film and that are on this list, that specifically Oliver Twist was the one story that gets on here twice. But it also is reflective on how important both these films are to the British film industry.
But I'm just going to say this right now, not to skip to the end too much, but it's kind of outrageous that we have two Oliver Twist movies and not a single Christmas Carol.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
Yeah, it's funny because you think about like Dickens and you think about his most known stuff, and I really believe that A Christmas Carol is probably his best known. Maybe it's different in England, but certainly here in North America, I would say that, yeah, A Christmas Carol is his best known work.
I mean, sure, let's keep Great Expectations. Let's keep an Oliver Twist, but I mean,
A Tale of Two Cities.
Yeah, but I mean, like, what are we doing?
Yeah.
We don't have A Christmas Carol. That's ridiculous. That 1951 would have been perfect.
Yeah. I mean, it's like that's such a... But you know what? We're not here to talk about Christmas or carols.
Or Scrooge.
No, we're here to talk about Oliver.
Exclamation mark.
Point.
You're a mark for exclamations.
I am really a mark for exclamations. I love it!
It's kind of embarrassing. I've been reading your forum.
Everything I say sounds so excited.
People thinking they know where punctuation is going, but they're just reading the dirt sheets.
Your opinion sucks.
What are you, Jim Cornette?
That's right.
yeah, exclamation point. Sorry. This movie, though, is directed by Carol Reed. And that name is interesting because, number one, he's Oliver Reed's uncle, which the producers did not know when they suggested him for the role, actually. He's also a director that we're going to see in the last movie we talk about because he directed The Third Man.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's quite a stark difference.
Yeah.
We have, of course, Mark Lester playing the role of Oliver Twist.
Mm-hmm.
We have Oliver Reed
playing
Bill Sykes.
The old piece of shit himself in fine form.
Also starring Ron Moody as Fagin. Shani Wallis as Nancy, Jack Wilde, who received a lot of accolades actually for such a young performer who plays the Artful Dodger, Joseph O'Connor as Mr. Brownlow, Meigs Jenkins as Mrs. Bedwin, and one scene, I think only one scene, but I gotta say Hugh Griffith as the magistrate.
Yes, very funny. Yes. Very good.
And very drunk. To which I noted, there's a bit where he ducks down and he's taking a drink and pretending to, like, you know, slouch down his chair. And I said, did they just film Hugh Griffith doing that and he didn't know?
Yeah, exactly. Wait, so is that the same guy who was in Tom Jones?
Yes.
Okay, wow. That makes sense. Also, casting-wise, I want to mention, it's a very small role, but I'll tell you, Brendan, one of my pleasures, one of the things I love to see when I'm watching these movies is if I see somebody I recognize from Are You Being Served in a movie, and the last time that happened was when we watched Alfie, because Alfie Bass...
Jude Law movie.
The original. Alfie Bass, of course, from Are You Being... who had briefly played Mr. Goldberg on Are You Being Served, was in it, and so I'm always on the lookout. This movie has a very brief role by James Hader, who plays Mr. Jessup, who's the bookseller that Oliver has to go to bring the money to.
Mm-hmm.
James Hader played Mr. Tebbs, on Are You Being Served in a similar capacity to Alfie Bass. He was one of the characters that replaced Mr. Granger. Mm. So it was wonderful to see his face just randomly be like, yeah, James Hader, sweet.
Well, so there you go.
Check out Are You Being Served, folks.
On your local,
still holds up.
On your local podcast.
100%.
Yeah, nothing offensive in that show.
Nothing offensive in that show.
Timeless as anything.
They just love getting drunk on Japanese tin wine.
Jason, this is a musical. I believe this is the only musical this list.
The only other musical I think we've watched was the Scrooge musical.
I think so. And the 1998 Avengers.
Of course.
I'm taking over the weather.
If only.
Uma Thurman, I find you sexually attractive.
So I cloned you. God damn that movie.
No, but I think this is the only musical. And Jason, I know you have a stance on musicals. Why don't you tell me your mission statement on musicals in general?
I generally don't like them. And
then follow
it's not
it
even
up,
that I don't like musicals.
And then follow it up with your opinion on women in general.
It's not that I don't like musicals, but it's that they for me, they tend to be very specific, the ones I like. Now, this My Fair Lady I like a lot because I was in it. But beyond that, I like musicals that are from the ground up built as musicals. Like Jesus Christ Superstar is a good example because it's not like they're doing like the story of the Bible and then jamming songs in there. They all the songs are written for telling that specific story in its own way. Whereas a movie like this, which I'm not going to say that this doesn't make it bad or anything, but like this is a movie where they had the story originally and then they jammed the songs in there. Yeah. And that can be good and can be bad.
So you're more of like a Sweeney Todd because that is a musical.
Yeah, like a musical from the start where
then
it's
like,
written with that in mind.
I can't even.
You know, or even something like, and I've never seen this and I never will probably because I don't think it'll ever be fully available, but like something like Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark, for instance, which is a good example of a movie. They were doing their own thing. They weren't just trying to like, oh, we're going to do Spider-Man 2, but we're going to do it on stage. No, they did their own story and wrote it from the start. Now, it wasn't successful, but I respect like from the ground up working like that.
I would have loved if they tried to just do Spider-Man 2 with all the same shots.
Alfred Molina could have been in it. I bet you he can sing.
But then, you know, when Doc Ock is forming, like, you know, starting his transformation, you just hear, but I still haven't found what I'm looking for. Because you two did the soundtrack.
Yeah. Wow.
A lot of people got hurt on that production.
I bet you they did.
We shouldn't make light of it.
We shouldn't.
So that's your stance on musicals.
Yeah, and like I say, I'm not against musicals. There are musicals I like. Like I said, I like My Fair Lady. I like Jesus Christ Superstar.
South Park,
I like
Bigger, Longer, and Uncut.
Chicago, Bigger, Longer, and Uncut, certainly. If the music resonates with me, certainly. And while Scrooge certainly didn't resonate with me musically, this one does a little more, but I think that's because this is a movie that is ingrained into pop culture. Like, I didn't realize how big a deal this movie was. You know, I mean, we'll talk about it later, but this won a lot of awards. Like, this was a huge fucking movie.
We don't really need to get into the plot. We've talked about Oliver Twist.
We did already talk about Oliver Twist. You know it. He's an orphan, whatever. He works for a funeral guy, and then he ends up with Fagin and his little boys.
A bunch of kid thieves.
Yeah, a bunch
we're
of
all
kid
being
thieves.
Groomed.
And we got Bill Sykes, who's an evil man.
Nancy's very sweet, and yes. He doesn't treat her right, and things go bad, and then he escapes, and he lives with a guy who is his real mom's uncle, and we find out he's rich.
Yeah.
There you go. That's the plot.
That's pretty much the plot.
But yeah, sorry. You were saying this movie, the huge part of pop culture.
Huge part of pop culture. And in my life, like, I realized watching this movie that, oh, I know a lot of these songs, and that maybe from The Simpsons, certainly some of them, because the opening one, the food, food, glorious food, I know Homer is saying that at some point. I certainly have heard Consider Yourself, to be a part of the family.
Do you know what that song really... I want to play it in a second.
Yeah.
But, okay, that song reminded me a lot of Every Sperm is Sacred.
Yes, exactly. There's no question that Every Sperm is Sacred drew inspiration from this song.
Which, yeah.
Also, when he's walking down the street and he's saying, boy for sale, that's, again, from The Simpsons. I'm pretty sure Skinner does that to Bart at some point or somebody, or maybe it's Milhouse.
No, you're right. That does sound
familiar. And that makes total sense because we think about The Simpsons. They've certainly drawn on musicals a lot over the years. We all know how Conan O'Brien was a huge fan of The Music Man, and that's how we ended up with the monorail episode. So it stands to reason that a musical as big as Oliver would make its way into...
make its way to the comedy world somehow.
Exactly.
I mean, a lot of people would have grown up with this.
Yeah.
And then a lot of people would have been showing. And if we talk about the BFI Top 100, the people that made this list in 1999, right? We're talking about people that are probably like older yeah. white men. We've made that joke many yeah. times. You know, people in their 50s or 60s who, when this movie came out,
were young adults. Were probably in their 20s. Like,
yeah, would have been their 20s, and then maybe their kids would have showed it to their little kids,
yeah.
and then they remember it, you know, 30 some odd years later. So, I mean, that ties into maybe why there's two Oliver Twist movies.
There's an interesting. I have an interesting theory about this movie too, about who might have been a big fan of it. Do you know anything about Mark Lester, who plays Oliver?
Well, I know he's in the movie. That's about it.
He became friends with a fella named Michael Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
And was quite close with him and has been in multiple documentaries.
Allegedly.
Now I'm not implying anything untoward, because I believe Mark Lester is actually older than Michael Jackson. But,
oh, okay.
But I wonder, either in the context of him being an abuser, if that was what happened, or in the context of him being the guy that, you know, misses his childhood and missed out. Like, it seems to me that Michael Jackson would be the sort of kid that would latch onto a movie like this. Like that he would see that as a possible expression of what childhood could be like to a guy who, you know, spent most of his childhood running around singing at concerts and stuff and living this life that most kids don't.
So let's take a listen, though, because you mentioned the Consider Yourself songs. This is when Oliver meets the Artful Dodger, played by Jack Wilde, who, again, I reiterate, got a lot of accolades for his performance.
And then died a bitter alcoholic.
Yeah, sad.
Yeah.
He is very charismatic, though, and he does little things that I really like in this movie, like Jack Wilde, who plays the Dodger. There's even scenes like where he's not the focus of the scene. He'll just be in the background, but he's still reacting. He's still acting at the same time.
He's not drawing focus, but he's reacting as the Dodger would.
Right, and he's doing it like a seasoned actor. Would like you don't see a lot of child actors able to do that.
You know what else you don't see, Brennan? Child actors that can smoke a pipe realistically.
You know what? I think they just had him smoke a pipe.
That's what I'm saying. He was literally just smoking. Now, whether that was tobacco or not, he was fucking smoking.
So let's take a listen at this song with Airful Dodger that might be Every Sperm is Sacred.
Consider yourself at home. Consider yourself one of the family. I've taken to you so strong. It's clear we're going to get along. Consider yourself well in. Consider yourself part of the furniture. There isn't a lot to spare. Who cares whatever we got we share. If it's your chance to be, we should see some harder days. Empty larder days, white grouse. Always your chance we'll meet somebody to foot the bill. Then the drinks are on the house. Consider yourself our mate. We don't want to have no fuss. For after some consideration, we can stay. Consider yourself one of us.
So there you go.
Yeah, you can definitely tell that Monty Python drew from that for that song.
Oh, and I mean, this was 1968. You wouldn't be able to convince me that Monty Python had not watched this movie.
Yeah, no, I mean, there's no. I mean, I feel like this was one of those movies based on how well it did at the Academy Awards that year. Like, this was something that everybody saw. Like, this was a cultural landmark of this era.
I mean, I'm not going to get to the awards yet, but I will say that this movie made almost 8 times its budget.
Well, that's a pretty good return.
Oh, so, I mean, and it cost $10 million.
Shit,
so there you go.
Man. That's all right. That's all right.
It's all right, all right, all right.
Yeah, it is all right, all right, all right. With this movie, something I noticed in this movie and didn't notice in David Lean's version as much, although it also applies, is that you notice all the kids speak really like low-class Cockney except for Oliver. And now, we later learn that Oliver is the son of this lady who was from a good family and all this. But it makes the uncomfortable implication that the way someone speaks is genetic. Which I don't think is the case.
Yeah. Well, yeah. All the other kids are very like Cockney.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But because he's from a rich family, of course, he speaks with a proper accent.
He's of the superior blood. You know, Jason, I can get into it. I have a manifesto here I can read to you.
And another issue I have.
Oh, you're not going to let me read my manifesto?
No, I'm not done yet, Brendan.
Sorry.
You keep that manifesto on pause. We'll get to it.
All right.
But my other issue with this movie, and it's a similar issue with the other one, and ultimately it's an issue with, I think, the original story, is that Oliver doesn't get nearly enough play in this movie. I get it. He's sort of the MacGuffin, right? He's the thing that the whole movie's based around. But it just always, in this one and in the last one, it feels like he doesn't get enough like stuff to do. And that sucks. Because, I mean, while everybody's great in this movie,
yeah.
Especially props to Oliver Reed, who I dislike, but is a fantastic actor.
A scary, scary both sides.
So scary in this movie. Yeah. Okay, let's go to that for a sec.
Well, I do want to comment on that, though, just for a second. Oliver, yes. Yeah. So he is very much like, we're basically Oliver.
Yeah.
We don't really have that much of a personality.
Yeah. No.
We're not super interesting. Everything interesting is happening around him.
Yeah.
Like with the other characters, like Artful Dodger, Fagin, Sykes, Nancy.
And the few really interesting things that happen with him kind of get glossed over in this movie. Like I noticed how
the opening.
So answer me a question. Do we see the locket up front at any point? Or is that just randomly introduced later on?
I didn't notice it
I did not notice it either. So I thought, and the fact that, in the lean version we have like seeing the mother and everything. Like,
so it does feel a little more tacked on in this one.
Yeah, or did they just ignored it? Like I think that maybe they just assumed, like I feel like this movie somewhat assumes that we all know the story. That if we're going to see Oliver Twist, we've seen some version of it or read it before.
No, that's also a good point too, because I do feel Oliver Twist, Lean's version, explains more, but not in a way, not like an expository way, but like they do tend to explain more details.
Well, and certain
which
things,
is crazy because this one is 30-40 minutes longer.
Yeah, and the other thing that kind of calls into that I was thinking of was like when we see what's his name? The guy early on, he's got the hat and he's the guy that runs the orphanage.
Oh,
what's his name? The Bull or not the Bull?
Johnny the Bull.
Johnny the Bull. Well, Johnny the Bull with his Napoleonic hat, right? He has that scene in this version where he's with his wife and then he starts, he questions him about taking orders from his wife and he talks about whatever. They don't set that up.
No, I wrote that down too. Yeah. That scene didn't play as well for me.
No, it didn't make a whole lot of sense because, of course, in the lean version, he has like this whole like thing about women, he talks about women or whatever. And then he's from a completely different perspective later on. And that's how the joke works.
But are we talking about Mr. Bumble?
Bumble, yes. Yeah. Mr. Bumble, yeah. Because he marries the lady he works with.
Yeah, he marries Mrs. Bedwin. Exactly. Because they have an earlier scene in the David Lean version where he says something about, women's work, blah, blah, blah. And then they pay that off with the later joke. But in this one, we just get the later bit.
We just get the punchline and we don't really get the context for it, that's why my theory is that this is for people who have seen it.
It could have been cut too.
Yeah.
That's very possible.
I wanted to mention too, Oliver Reed is fantastic in this. As I said, what I like about him in this is that he plays a very different kind of Sykes than the other one, than the gentleman in the previous, in the lean film. In the lean film, I get the sense Sykes is certainly dangerous, but he's got this grumpiness to him that you kind of know where he stands. Like you kind of know where he's at. Like he's an asshole and he's angry, but you can kind of gauge where he is. Oliver Reed is a Sykes that is ready to explode at any moment. Well, and you don't know when. You just know that he is fucking on the edge at every second.
Well, let's listen to when he starts to get really paranoid later in the movie, when he's afraid that Oliver Twist is going to say something to someone or has said something to someone, and he's intimidating Fagin.
Yeah.
And we got to talk about Fagin too after this, but as he's intimidating Fagin, this relationship, by the way, much different in this movie because I think Fagin is like in Oliver Twist, the lean version is very like, calculating and very conniving.
He always knows he's kind of in control.
In this one, Sykes is very much in control.
Absolutely.
Get to bed, I said! All this violence, all these scenes, screams, dramas! I'm asking you, is it necessary?
Not yet, Fagin. Not yet. But if this godforsaken little good-for-nothing's heard one word, mind you.
If he has, the little devil. We sit down, we talk it over, we think it out, we decide upon a proper course of safe action, we stay calm!
Do we? And while we're sitting here, thinking and talking and staying calm, our collars get felt, don't they? And it's come along with me, if you please. No, thank you very much. Look, you thought us into this little lot. You can think your way out of it. But from now on, Bill Sykes takes the law into his own hands. These hands. Have you ever heard the sound a chicken makes when they're a-ringing off its neck? say I ever had the they squawks, Fagin. They squawks. Not a very pretty sound. No, Bill. And then they dies, don't they? Yes, Bill. We know, Bill. And then they say some even start squawking before that event. They get what you might call a premonition. Now then, you wouldn't be having no premonition of that sort by any chance, would you? Not me, Bill. The lips are sealed. I'm glad, because if anyone here should lead the law to me, and I gets to hear of it, then it will be your neck. Your scraggy old neck.
Yeah, so right there you get an his very calm intimidation and scariness. He's very calm and scary. Calm and scary is the scariest, by the way.
Yeah, the quiet burn, you know.
Yeah, and the fact that he is very much, again, you can hear he's talking to Fagin. He's very much in control of Fagin. Mm-hmm. There is no instance in this movie where Fagin finds a roundabout way to convince that Sykes that maybe he should kill Nancy.
Yeah.
That happens in the other one.
Yeah, no, that absolutely does.
And in this one, he's horrified.
Fagin is a much more sympathetic character in this version. He's clearly...
a little goofier.
A little goofier, cares more about the boys. And obviously, they toned down the eternal Jew stereotype that...
considerably.
But I would still say, I believe this version clearly draws on Alec Guinness's performance. Like, Ron Moody is... in that ballpark, like even his voice sounds similar, but again, moderate it, like tone down, like not just, not so thickly accented, but especially even when he sings that song, he starts singing in a foreign accent that kind of calls back a little bit to that.
Wait a second, what are you talking about, my dears?
My dears. Yeah, he does say my dears, and they do sound a bit nasally, but not as...
Oh, no, and it's me. It's me, Fagin.
Hi, Fagin.
You don't like my performance, my dears?
No, it's a fantastic performance. It's more just the implications of the performance.
I don't know what you're talking about. Oi, my knees. Oh, God.
No, see, now, you know, it's not really acceptable to kind of stereotype a whole race like that.
Okay, well, hold on, my dears. My glasses are slipping off my nose, you see, because it's quite long.
Yeah. I suppose it is. It's. I don't even think any human has a nose that
I'm
big.
I'm not going to give you a penny, my dears. You get it because I keep the money. Goodbye, jetpack.
Wait, so Fagin's in Republican Heaven? I guess that makes sense. He'd probably fit in there.
That version.
That version specifically. Yeah. I didn't know. I guess fictional characters can go to heaven too.
Fictional heaven. Wait, isn't that just called heaven?
Wait, does that mean Fagin must die somewhere? Does Fagin die in a sequel? Okay, yes. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Does Fagin die in a sequel? Is there a sequel to this?
Yeah, Oliver Twisted.
Yeah. Well, actually, there is a movie called Twisted, which is... I saw there was a couple movies. There was one from 97 and one from 2003 that were like modern remakes of Oliver Twist, and I think they were had a lot of gay stuff in there, too.
Wonderful. Let's do them. Let's do them and now for something completely similar.
We'll do a double header with Cruisin' and Twist.
Header. Jason, I also note that we talk about Oliver Reed as Bill Sykes. He's the only character that doesn't sing.
No, that's probably smart.
But I mean, he probably didn't want to sing or whatever, or he didn't sing. But it's interesting that they make that character not sing, because it does give him something different than anyone else.
It does, and I think making him sing would probably humanize him too much as a villain. Like it humanizes all the other characters, like, because we get that scene with Fagin teaching the boys how to pickpocket in song. Nancy dancing around and singing the Oompa song at the end.
You mean you wouldn't want to have Oliver Reed being like, consider yourself a friend.
Consider yourself in the family.
I do want to talk about Nancy, because Nancy is, again, it's Sykes' girlfriend. And, well, something.
Yeah.
He owns her.
She certainly thinks that.
Yeah. And she has a song here that is very happy, but if you listen to the lyrics, it's not very happy.
If you don't mind taking it like it turns out, it's a fine. Keep the candle burning until it burns out. It's a fine. Girl, you sometimes do come by. You can always cover one till he blacks the other one, but you don't dare
cry. No flounces, no feathers, no frills and fur pillows. All winds and all weathers ain't good for fancy clothes.
These trappings,
these tatters,
these we can just afford. What future, what matters? We've got our bed and board.
So that was not the song that I thought it was. There's a scene later on where after she gets slapped, she sings. She's like up on the bridge outside the...
Yeah,
and she's singing about Bill.
No. So that one is early on. That's how we kind of meet Nancy. And that song is, it sounds peppy and poppy, but if you listen to the lyrics, she's saying like, you know, if he blackens one eye, just cover up, cover the other one or whatever. Like, it's just like, you know, smile and grit your teeth and bear through it. It's dark.
Classic British, you know, stiff upper lip stuff.
It's also a lot more heavily implied in this movie that they are prostitutes. Like, I feel like in the lean version, it was a bit more subtle. Mm. In this one, I think it's more heavily implied.
It's funny. Maybe I'm just naive, but that didn't even enter into my head.
Really?
Yeah.
I just got the idea about like them talking about like taking people upstairs and stuff like that.
And that's legitimate. I must just not have been listening closely. I'm glad you're here to destroy my innocence. Mm-hmm. Wait, are you still evaluating me?
Yeah, it's going on your performance report.
God damn it.
It's okay, Jason. You've got till the end of the list to shape up.
I promise. I'm gonna try my best, sir, and I'm gonna improve my performance, and I'm gonna make you proud.
Thanks, son.
Daddy,
have you ever met a one-legged dog making his way down the street? You ever seen a one-trick pony? Well, you seen me.
Is that a Bruce
Springsteen
song?
Well, you seen me. The dough.
I'll do you one better.
Some boys like trucks, some others like beer.
That's just for Brendan.
It's just for me and no one else. Whereas I appeal
well,
to the mainstream.
If you Google Rex on YouTube, R-E-X,
just that, you'll find
and
it
Brendan
right away.
And Jason, you might find something. But
yeah, sure. Go for it. Maybe I'll throw the link up if I remember.
Yeah. We can let them see our work.
Okay, so Nancy. I feel like Nancy is a much brassier character in this movie. I feel like I really do like her in the Oliver Twist, the 1948 version.
But she's a darker character.
She's a much more put-upon character. In this movie, I feel like she has more agency.
Question. So we remember in this version, much as in the other version, Oliver gets sent out by the rich guy with a 5-pound note in his pocket and a stack of books to go see Mr. Jessup, right?
Mm-hmm.
In the David Lean version, do you remember what happened? Like, didn't they just like grab him? Like, cause in this version, Nancy comes up to him and starts talking to him and Bill kind of skulks behind and then Bill grabs him.
Yeah. In the last one, they do kind of grab him and then I think the police come by and they have to like come up with some excuse.
Yeah. Cause I feel like if he'd have seen Nancy, like in the previous version, then he would know he was fucked and he would probably try to take off. But in this version, he immediately just starts talking to her and then Bill grabs him.
Yeah. That's not as effective. No. I agree.
No, but this is a softer movie. This is a much more broad, you know, obviously. No, I'm not saying that David Lean made like some really niche independent film about Oliver Twist, but what I'm saying is that this is a much broader movie.
This
for a bigger audience, you know, musicals in the late 60s, that was like the tentpole. That was the blockbuster of the day.
I would argue softer, but still a bit of an edge to it.
Mm.
More than I expected, because this was rated G at the time.
Yes.
And there are, I mean, that song alone where she's talking about getting beaten, that wouldn't fly today in a G-rated film.
I'll tell you what kind of change I liked, because doesn't Bill kill his dog in the other movie?
No, he does not.
Oh.
The dog gets away both times.
Does he get away? Because in this one, though, he sells him out. He straight up sells him out. He's like leading the mob of people.
No, that's what he does in both versions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, poor doggy.
Well, doggy's fine. Doggy makes it.
Yay, doggy fine.
She's much more brassy. She's much more, I think she has a little bit more agency in this movie. So it makes like the scene where she, you know, Sykes kills her, almost like even scarier.
Yeah.
Because, and it's all off screen. all we see is him coming down with like his, you know, his cane or whatever, and he just beats her to death.
Yeah.
And he comes out and he, like, he's covered in blood. But in this movie too, I never get the sense that he loved her. In the 1948 one, I think you are meant to believe that there is a love there.
Yeah, and that Fagin's the one that manipulates that death into happening. Whereas in this one, it kind of by nature has to be more brutal because he has to do it of his own volition rather than just being convinced to do it.
Yeah. I don't think he loves her at all.
No, he doesn't give a shit. She's there and available for him when he needs her. And if she disappeared tomorrow, he'd find somebody else.
But you know what, Jason? You know what everyone does love? They all love Nancy. And I just wanna let you hear about how much everyone loves Nancy.
Okay.
I'd do anything for you, dear. Anything for you. Mean everything to me. I know that I'd go anywhere for your smile. Anywhere for your smile. Everywhere I'd see.
Would you climb a hill?
Anything.
Wear a daffodil?
Anything.
Leave me all your will?
Anything.
Even fight my bill?
What fisticuffs I'd risk? Everything for one kiss. Everything, yes, I'd do. Anything.
Anything.
Anything for you.
And I think that segs nicely into our discussion on Fagin, because that song, you can sort of see Fagin in the background kind of feeling a little unappreciated, because he comes into the song later and starts singing, and then they start saying, I'd do anything for you.
Yeah.
And he really turns it around. And at this point in the movie, I'm still like, okay, so this is where he's going to start like hating her and convincing Sykes to kill her. Like, I thought they were still going to go down that route, but
no.
They do not. And in fact, he actually gets a happy ending.
Yeah, he does. He does. He initially has the brief idea of maybe reforming himself and going straight. But then Dodger shows up and it's just like, ah, fuck it. We're going to be criminals together and show the crime pays.
And I guess that's a relationship that doesn't age well. I mean, come on. I mean, you know, even Back to the Future, why is he hanging out with that old man?
That is a good question. Well, this really is the Back to the Future of its era.
Yes, Robert Zemeckis saw this movie and was like, I want to do this again, but for 1985.
Also, I think it's ballsy of Dodger to say he'd do anything for her, because I think if Bill found out that he'd said something like that, he'd probably fight the guy. I don't think he loves Nancy, but he's very territorial.
Yes. Oh, he's like, it's funny because the Bill has a dog, because he is like a dog, like a very, like a bulldog, but not a nice dog.
This dog reminds me of the set dog that was in The Little Rascals.
I thought he was like Don Cherry's dog.
Yeah, that same kind of like a pincer or something. I don't know dogs. Folks, if you know dogs, tell us what kind of dog this was.
And invite them, because we want to see all kinds of doggies.
Oh, we love doggies. Please show us your doggies.
So Ron Moody. Yes. Ron Moody is Fagin. You mentioned he's doing a little Guinness.
He's doing a little bit of Guinness.
He's toning down the eternal Jew stereotype.
Yeah. Smaller nose, you know.
Yeah.
Less of a foreign accent.
I do really like him.
Yeah, no, he's good. He's entertaining.
I think he does a wonderful job. I think again, like you said, No fault of Mark Lester, but I think all the supporting performances are so much more interesting.
Yeah.
And, you know, whether it's Nancy or Bill or Fagin or Dodger, like they're all very fully developed characters.
Yeah. And it's funny. It's interesting watching this, having watched the other one and being similarly kind of creeped out by the way that Fagin, like, manipulates trains, like trains these boys to pickpocket. Like he turns it into a game and everything. Like, and then we have the big song with that. But in this one, you get the sense that he really does give a shit about the boys. Like, it's not just about the money. He does have his treasure hoard, you know, that he's concerned about, but he's, and as we see at the end of the movie, he's not an irredeemable character. We have that moment too, at the end, where he loses all his jewels in the mud.
Yes.
Yeah, which not something that happens in the previous version.
No, he just gets arrested in the other one. Because I think in 1948, you had to have all the villains get their comeuppance.
Yeah, exactly. It was probably part of the code, yeah.
That's a big difference, too, because in 1968, I mean, fuck, Easy Rider had already come out. Yeah. You don't have to... The rules are meant to be broken at this point.
Yeah, and they...
I'm saying this was on the experimental level of an Easy Rider.
No, but I mean, they break rules in the sense that they change the story to their own...
Yeah.
Own volition.
Villains getting away with it.
Yeah, and with this type of movie, I understand why you want to change Fagin like that, because Fagin is such an entertaining character and charismatic, and you get why the boys like him. I understand the dramatic desire to go as it did in the lean version and show what a piece of shit he was, and I appreciated that. But also for this sort of broad, you know, audience pleasing comedy, this works better.
Yeah. And, you know, we talk a lot about the song. We've heard quite a few of the songs so far, but I want to know what you think overall of the music in this film.
I mean, it's fine. It is.
Does anything stick out in your craw?
Just because I know them from pop culture, like I said, with Consider Yourself, like that's a song I just know from hearing in other shows referencing. Like, I've never seen this movie once in my life, and I knew Consider Yourself. Like I said, I knew the Glorious Food. It's classic musical stuff. It's, I would certainly say it's more memorable than Scrooge. I think I may have said that earlier.
You did, yeah.
But it's not a soundtrack that I would be playing.
I want to play an example of, like, I think a lot of the songs in this movie are interesting. Like, they're character introductions. Some of them do progress the plot a little bit. But there are a few that I just, like, I'm looking at the time and I'm like, okay, this is 2 hours and 33 minutes. Yeah. We don't need this one. We don't need this one. There's a few that we don't need. And I want to play.
And they go on for so long.
That every song is very long. And I want to play an example of one of the songs I just feel just doesn't, it's just so unnecessary.
Who will buy my sweet red roses to blooms for us?
That song is a cool sequence, but what is it about? It's about the people selling shit outside this rich person's house.
There's ultimately nothing wrong with the song. No. I just feel like it doesn't need to be there. Like,
and it's a big fucking number too.
It's a huge number, and Oliver gets to sing in part of it. By the way, his singing voice, the most obvious, not the actor singing voice I've ever heard.
Well, it's okay.
I mean, I'm pretty sure it was a woman singing for Oliver, but
probably.
But yeah, it's just like it goes on so long, and it just feels like it's a way of showing that he's in this new environment, because that's when he goes, you know, with the old man who's just like, I'm gonna take this kid now.
Hmm.
That's not a thing you can do anymore.
Yeah, no, you can't just take him from court with you.
And it's show that he is in a much more positive environment. But honestly, those people are singing at the top of their lungs every morning, and I'm trying to record a goddamn podcast.
But of course, classist as well, because we have to assume that because he's in an upper class environment or a higher class environment, that he's in a better environment.
Sure. Yeah.
I will say, though, the number is impressive. That's the thing about this movie. They didn't spare any expense on the scale of the numbers. Like, there are a lot of fucking people, a lot of dancers doing a lot of really intricate choreography. And actually, this number specifically, I was scared for the dancers, because they were like, the dudes were like climbing up the ladder, and they were like doing these like swings around on these balconies, which are clearly very far off the ground. Like, they're, you know, 10, 12 feet up. Like,
are you saying you were concerned about 1968 safety protocols?
Yes, absolutely. I wanted to make sure that those people weren't hurt and that they could live the rest of their lives and then die, because I assume they're all dead now.
I think most of them. Mark Lester's still kicking.
He is. He's in his like 60s now. Yeah.
Yeah.
Unlike the Oliver from the lean version, who had the fucking audacity to go and die a few years ago.
What an asshole.
What a dickhead. Look, I've said it before, man. If you were smart, you wouldn't have died.
Mm-hmm. You would have figured out a way to cheat death like Devon Sawa in Final Destination.
That's right. That's the movie that defines my life.
Defines.
I haven't actually seen it, but just the idea of it defines my life.
Defines a generation.
Yeah.
Really.
Because isn't that destination truly all of our final destinations?
Listen, when I first saw that movie, I was scared out of my mind.
Now, this is because you're a pussy.
Or I was very young.
How young were you?
I don't know, like 15?
Oh, you pussy. God, you're such a nerd.
And then it ended with that song. I'm not scared of dying and don't really care if it's peace you find in dying with a diamond hair.
And that made you feel better.
So open up my coffin, cause it's cold down here. Yeah, it's crazy cold down here.
Now, did you see the reboot?
Maybe that's not such a great song.
Did you see the reboot of that?
The reboot?
Yeah, the new Final Destination that came out a few years ago.
One of the sequels, you mean?
It's sort of a reboot, isn't it?
I think they're all sequels.
No, whatever.
But enough about
you didn't answer my question! Did you see it?
I think I've seen them all. I don't know.
You're useless to me.
But enough about
just because you do all the work on this podcast doesn't mean you're useless. It doesn't mean you aren't useless to me.
Don't make me do it, Jason.
Do what?
Jacques?
No!
Jason!
No!
You need to treat him with more respect.
I'm sorry, Brendan. Send him away.
No. Jason, just sign that right there. Give all your money to parlay.
I'm not joining parlay.
Look,
I don't know if you've heard about Getter, but that seems to be the place for right-wing idiots.
So. Oh, hashtag January 6th, not on Parlay. We ban it.
I don't think you did, but...
Well, we ban it as of now to get you to pay Parlay.
You tell you what, I'll send you a telegram.
Okay, jetpack.
Oh, thank God.
Jason, don't fuck with me. Don't fuck with me.
I promise, sir, I will no longer fuck with
don't
you.
Don't fuck with me. Okay, but so there's good music, there's pointless music. I want to play another clip of a song that's intended. So in a musical, when you have a musical number, in the world of the movie, no one is actually singing. Like, you know, right? Like,
no, they're all just thinking about it.
It's a metaphorical thing. Yeah. But I think in this scene, it's the only instance where they are actually singing in the movie. And this is a late scene where Nancy has to... Because Nancy, throughout this movie, like we said, compared to the other one, she's much more obviously nice.
Yeah.
She's not... There's nothing ambiguous. She wants to help Oliver.
Yeah.
So in this scene, she's trying to get Oliver out of the bar. He's under guard by Sykes's dog. She tries to get him out, and the way she does it is she hears people singing the song off in the distance in the pub, and so she tries to like rally everyone to start singing and to create a distraction so she can whisk him away.
If this isn't the last song in the movie, it's pretty close. It's like the second last song.
Yeah, I think it is the last song, because I think after this it starts getting real intense.
Yeah.
So I want to take a listen to this one, because this is the only song, again, I think actually is being sung in the world of the movie.
Pretty little Sally goes walking down the alley, displays her pretty ankles for all of the men. They can see her garters, but not for free and gratis, an inch or two, and then she knows when to say when. That's how it goes. But now she's up a gum tree. She let a fella feed her, then lead her along. What's the good of crying? She's made her bed to lie in. She's glad to bring the coin in and join in this song.
As Brendan, an extremely white man, I must say that this tickles my soul. I love oompa music.
You love what?
Oompa music.
Oompa music. Like, is that a genre? Kind of,
yeah. It's like from like Germany and Finland, like Poland kind of stuff. Like, you know, the oompa, 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 oompa.
I didn't know it was a whole thing.
Yeah, no, you should look it up. It's a lot of accordions and things like that. It's great.
And so that song, you know, acts as her way to get him out of there. And then, you know, we get to the finale where... He murders Nancy, like we said. Sykes has Oliver Twist. He gets stopped. Oliver Twist is safe.
He gets hanged.
Fagin is going to continue grooming Dodger. And
Yeah. And Oliver, we have a very brief scene at the end of Oliver going back to the rich people.
Yes. Now, another thing I want to talk about is the music in this. Jason, we might be getting into a hot take here.
Hot take.
I just want you to get ready. Get the ice cubes out.
Oh, I'm ready to be scorched, baby. Give it to me.
Ooh. Okay. I don't think... So, I think I do like a lot of the songs on their own. However, I think in the context of this movie, I think combined with the... I gotta say, not great cinematography. I'm not a huge fan of the cinematography of the, especially the choreography of the songs. Yeah. The choreography itself is fine, like the way they're like, you know, they have it organized. But the cinematography, like the shots, nothing really special to me.
It's there's a color to it, but yeah, it's
very point and shoot.
It didn't feel that different from Scrooge, like kind of a similar approach to building a musical. Now, obviously, Scrooge was after this, but
like I think if you take this and like I don't know. Mary Poppins or like Sound of Music, I think those are much more visually interesting. Whereas this one is just kind of, they're just kind of filming a like a musical play.
Yeah, yeah. They're doing a lot of like the sort of dancing they'd be doing on stage, but instead they're doing it in. And now I will say for the set design, I love the areas that they filmed in. Like it all looks very authentic. They got a lot of people.
Some of it looks kind of stagey, but yes.
Yeah, but you know, for the most part, it looks pretty good. But yeah, it's. And also, it's a musical, and with this sort of musical, the songs are just, they feel like they go on forever sometimes.
They're too long.
They're, like, because I think about how economical the David Lean version was with the plot.
Yeah, that was one, like, I mean, that was under 2 hours.
Under 2 hours, and it gets all the major points down, and we lose some stuff in this one, and yeah, these songs just blow out. And it's like we have 5 straight minutes of like dancing around and whatever.
I mean, the opening of the movie, I wrote down the opening of the movie. We don't have spoken dialogue until about 18 minutes in.
Wow. Yeah. That's because see them singing about food.
Food, glorious food. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
So, I mmean, I don't know, man. Any other big things you want to talk about before we get into
it's all the bits and bobs, baby.
Save for the bits and bobs. All right, well, we're gonna be right back after we hear a word from our sponsors.
Age of Radio.
Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
The great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day, wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.
Please, sir, may I have some more bits and bobs?
More bits and bobs? Don't you know enough about the movie already?
I want bits and bobs. Yes, I want them now.
Okay.
Please give me some bits.
I will.
And then give some bobs.
I'm gonna.
Bits and bobs. Bits and bobs. Give me bits and bobs.
I will. I'm gonna. Just stop it. Just stop it. I like the overture card when we're watching the very beginning of the movie. The illustration, I think, is reminiscent of what would have been in the books, like in an actual printed copy or even in the periodicals where this story probably would have been originally serialized. Like it had that real feel to it. So I thought that was cool. It's a Romulus production, which it is certainly not produced by the Romulans, babe. Let me tell you something about the Romulans. If this was a Romulan movie, babe, this Oliver kid, he'd be fucking backstabbing all these other kids, babe, and he would take over Fagin's job.
I also didn't see a competing production by Remus, babe.
That's how Dennis Miller laughs, right? I enjoy the irony of them all being shoveled into this workhouse, and then on the wall embossed is just God is love.
I like how the other kids in this one don't like Oliver. Did you notice that? Like when Boss Hogg or whatever the fuck his name is, what's his name, Mr. Bumble?
Yeah,
Boss Hogg is singing that song about you know how Oliver's a piece of shit. The kids are joining in.
Yeah,
they're kind of like, yeah, fuck this guy.
Yeah, just, I think seems mean. I like how the kids are on side with Oliver. He's just the one that they make go ask for more food.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was gonna say I miss the grittiness of the lean version. Like, there's a lot that's missing from this one, and I get it, that's not what this is, but just watching it, it felt like something was missing. Like, we see all the stuff with the funeral director and stuff, but that scene, how that works in the original movie where the older boy is making fun of Oliver's mother and then he goes off on him, it feels very like just the best of, like it's literally just a quick overview in this movie, it happens and then it's done, and that guy doesn't feel nearly as intimidating or creepy as the dude in the lean version.
That scene is very, very quick.
Absolutely.
It's crazy the stuff that they spend so little time on and the stuff they spend more than enough time on in this movie compared to the other one.
Yeah. When they go to Fagin's hideout, similarly to the other one, they have that bridge in front of it. Like, they climb up all those stairs and then they cross that bridge and they get into it. And I'm wondering if that was like from the illustrations, like from back then, if that's why that's kind of a common element. If that's just how the house was described in the book.
I like the detail of the tattered UK flag in Fagin's place. That was a nice little touch.
This is what England has made us.
Yeah.
Kids smoking, good for them. Keeping it real. Oh, I like the line where he goes, "Shut up and drink your gin."
To a child,
yeah.
Yeah. Goddamn, Jason, hold on. We need to talk about I think we're not respecting Fagin enough. I think we need to hear him sing.
Okay, well, let's hear Fagin sing.
In this life, one thing counts in the bank, large amounts. I'm afraid these don't grow on trees. You got to pick a pocket or two. You got to pick a pocket or two, boys.
You got to pick a pocket or two.
Large amounts don't grow on trees. You got to pick a pocket or two.
Let's show a bit how to do it, my dears. Just a game, Oliver, just a game.
Why should we break our backs stupidly paying tax? Better get some untaxed income. Better pick a pocket or two. You gotta pick a pocket or two, boys. You gotta pick a pocket or two.
Sorry, Jason, but I think we need to hear some of that.
That is a great song. That is one of the better songs in this movie, I would say. I enjoy
the his and the Dodgers song, Consider Yourself, are probably the two best ones.
Very fun. Very fun songs. I noticed in this movie and in kind of from other movies I've seen him in, Oliver Reed has a real talent for glancing between things.
Okay.
He'll look at one person and then look at the other. And it's just, he's really good at that because he's got those fucking fantastic eyes. So check him out doing that. Also, who has good reactions is that owl.
Yes.
That owl was fucking great. He was talking to that owl about, and the owl was reacting appropriately.
I also like how, by the way, speaking of Sykes, how he has that big shadowy introduction.
Mm.
He enters and it's completely his shadow, and the shadow gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And then when he shows up, you're like, whoa.
Yeah, there he is.
This is also very early Oliver Reed, by the way. So this is not like he didn't have like much of a acting reputation at the time.
Well, this must have helped.
Well, coming into this movie like this with this kind of presence, yeah.
I laughed at the line, "You promised we could go to the hanging," and Fagin responds, "But just make sure it's not your own." And that's, I mean, absolutely. Executions were public entertainment for hundreds and hundreds of years.
Kids were very excited to see someone's life.
Yeah, well, you would take your kids there, the idea being that they would learn that this is what happens if you're bad.
Yep. Unless Owen Wilson saves you at the last second.
When we get into that pointless number, I thought nothing more than of Eliza Doolittle, the flower girl, and thought, ooh, is this like the prequel to My Fair Lady?
Could be.
Yeah, the locket came into the picture late and didn't really have any impact if you didn't know the story.
Mm-hmm.
It feels like it was literally just inserted to solve that problem.
I did notice in this one, when they're in town, the kids are in town, and Oliver gets blamed for stealing from that old man. I think in this one, they make it look like the Dodger and the other kid are trying even harder to help him.
Yeah.
Because I think in the original, they kind of run off with him, and then they're like, oh, fuck this guy.
Yeah,
caught.
They kind of like use it as an excuse to get the fuck away. Whereas in this one, they actually do kind of try to get him out of there.
They do eventually, when he gets caught, they kind of slink away. Yeah. But for a long time, they're trying to get him out.
Well, they made the effort, and the fact that Fagin told him, told Dodger, like, don't let anything happen to him. Mm-hmm. They obviously feel pretty bad about going back without him. When Sykes and Oliver try to rob that place, and then, they get discovered and they take off, Buddy pulls out a pistol from the window and fires at them. That is it's like a flintlock pistol or something. There's no way he could hit anything from his window with that pistol.
That's another scene, by the way, that's not in the lean version.
No, certainly not.
Sykes making Oliver go on a job with him.
No.
And Oliver fucks it up. Yeah. So Sykes doesn't get anything, and he's very upset.
Very upset. This seemed like another very dangerous scene to film. When they're all climbing up the stairs in the mud and the stairs start to collapse, there's people actors on that stairs with fucking torches that are on fire. Like, I thought, this is bad. This could go really fucking bad for these people.
And if you think, if you're listening to that and you think, oh, that was 1968, let me just remind you that there was a Resident Evil movie where a bunch of people dressed like zombies were supposed to walk off the side of a building, and there was supposed to be a safety net there. They forgot to put the safety net, and they had to send like 50 people to the hospital, and the doctors couldn't tell what were their real injuries because they were in zombie makeup.
Yeah, that would be a real problem. Ouch.
So that shit still happens, unfortunately, from time to time.
And he's still making Resident Evil movies.
I don't know. I think they're done now.
My last note here is that Oliver is sort of the proto Anakin Skywalker from Phantom Menace, where the movie kind of happens around him.
And Nancy tells him that he's breaking her heart.
Yeah, and then he grows up and fucks Nancy and has a couple of twins.
Yeah, and somehow she's the same age that she was when he was 8 years old. Yep. That always weirded me out.
That was a strange. Well, I think the point, I think Princess Amidala was supposed to be like, maybe like 16 or 17.
But you know what?
It's only an 8-year difference. My wife and I have an 8-year difference.
But guess who doesn't? But guess who doesn't look older than Hayden Christensen? Natalie Portman.
That is true. That is true. They should have brought Jake Lloyd back.
God, might be worse.
Probably, but still better.
Nancy has another great breakdown in this movie, where she wants to save Oliver. I do like the song I'm reviewing the situation when, Fagin is, maybe he might go good. He doesn't. No. Fagin is very disturbed at Bill's attack and murder of Nancy. He says, whose blood is that? Where's Nancy? He's very uncomfortable.
Bruce. I want some brass. I've got to get away.
What's wrong, Bill?
The order said I want brass, brass, money!
There's blood on your coat. Where's Nancy? Bill? Bill Sykes? What did you do? What did you do?
She won't beat on nobody no more.
Shouldn't have done that. She peached. Are you sure?
Well, she must have done, mustn't she? She was handing the boy over to Brownlow on the bridge. He was there waiting for her.
What did you come here for? Get out, do you hear me? Get out!
I want money.
How much? 10? 20?
Not all of it. And if the law should come here asking for me,
they won't find me here. You think I'm going to stand here and wait for them, do you?
And the last note I have is that I love how in that whole finale, when they're all standing around, they're relieved that Oliver's safe or whatever. You see the Dodger and he just takes someone's wallet.
Yep.
During that whole thing, that's a great touch. But that's all I really have for bits and bobs as well. So let's talk about the reaction this movie gets, Jason, because you alluded to this several times, but it does very well critically. It is not. Now I'll tell you the first of all, the ones it is nominated for, the Oscars it is nominated for and doesn't win, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Wow.
Any guesses as to some of them?
I'm pretty sure that the young lad that played the Artful Dodger was nominated for Best Supporting Actor.
Best Supporting Actor. The winner that year was Jack Albertson for The Subject Was Rose. Best Adapted Screenplay.
Okay.
The winner that year was The Lion in Winter. Best Costume Design. The winner was Zeffirelli's Romeo and Juliet. Remember we talked about Zeffirelli in the Withnell and I episode because he was the aggressive actor who may have tried to sexually assault the director.
Oh.
Remember he based that.
Right. Yes.
Best Cinematography was nominated, but Romeo and Juliet won that as well. Best Editing was won by a little movie I think you've definitely heard of, at least, called Bullet.
Yes, certainly. Steve McQueen.
Another acting award it was nominated for was actually for Ron Moody.
Oh.
For playing Fagin, but it was won by Cliff Robertson for the movie Charlie. But it wins 5 awards.
Nice.
Guess one.
Well, best score.
Yeah. So best sound, best score, best art direction, best director for Carol Reed.
Wow.
He won over Kubrick for 2001.
God damn.
Just want to put that out there.
Wow.
It also won best picture. I mean, it won Best Picture. The other nominees were Funny Girl, The Lion in Winter, Rachel, and Romeo and Juliet.
I wonder if Rachel is the basis for the Rochelle joke on Seinfeld.
Well, DM Michael Richards. He'll respond to you.
Yeah, I'm sure he will.
At the BAFTAs, Jason, this is crazy. It doesn't win a single BAFTA.
What?
It is nominated. All these are just nominations.
Crazy. You would think that a movie that did so well in Hollywood would also do well in Britain.
So... It is nominated for Best Overall Film. The winner is The Graduate. It is also nominated for Best Actor for Ron Moody, but it loses to Spencer Tracy for Guess Who's Coming to Dinner.
Oh.
It is nominated for Best Director. It loses to Mike Nichols for The Graduate. Best Costume Design. The winner was Romeo and Juliet. Best Editing goes to The Graduate. Best Production Design, 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Did The Graduate not get nominated for any Academy Awards this year, or was it in a different year?
It might have been a different year. I'm not sure. The BAFTAs are weird because, you know, they go by their release dates, right? Best Sound, 2001, won that. Most Promising Newcomer for Jack Wilde. The winner that year was Dustin Hoffman for The Graduate.
Wow.
So they were shut out of the BAFTAs,
which
is crazy. But this movie got, like, widespread acclaim. Pauline Kael loved it. Roger Ebert gave it 4 out of 4 stars. He said, Sir Carol Reed's Oliver is a treasure of a movie. It is very nearly universal entertainment. One of those rare films like The Wizard of Oz that appeals in many ways to all sorts of people. Adults will like it for the sweep and zest of its production. And as a work of popular art, it will stand the test of time. It's as well made as a film can be. He thought that he really praised the idea that the kids didn't seem to be talked down to, that they were presented as full adult characters just like anyone else.
Yeah, they felt real, yeah.
He said it's got bite and malice along with romance and humor, although he did criticize the length of the film as a roadshow presentation because it was aimed at children. He said that you might have a hard time getting kids to sit down for this long.
For 3.5 hours, yeah.
Well, 2.5.
2.5 hours.
Jesus Christ.
It felt like 3.5.
And of course he praised Ron Moody and Jack Wilde. And Roger Ebert said it was his, 7th favorite film of 1968. And no, I don't know what the other ones were. again, $10 million budget, $77.4 million box office.
It's a good return.
Jason Oliver, what'd you think?
It's a solid musical. It's iconic. It's clearly important. It clearly was a massive deal in Britain because it showed the British could make a musical on the level of a Hollywood musical, I have to imagine, like to show that they could do that too. At the end of the day, if you had to watch one Oliver Twist, I would say watch the David Lean one. I liked it a lot better as a story, but this is a cool movie. And if you're into musicals, I don't think you can go wrong with this. But it's not my favorite musical, certainly.
Yeah.
But the songs are, but again, I'll say the songs are more memorable than the Christmas Carol movie we watched, because I can't think of a song from that movie.
I was kind of cold to this movie.
Yeah.
A little bit. I mean, we talk about the songs. I do, I did like some of the songs. I like the performances. Everything is like, everything's working, but it's just not fully coming together for me. I still would say like I have an overall positive reaction to this movie, but it's a very like base level. Like it's fine to me. Like it's crazy to think that this was a Best Picture winner.
Yeah.
But
I mean, this
is
back
concerned.
When musicals were huge and could win Best Picture.
Sure, but I don't even think it fully, like I said, I felt like I was watching sometimes a filmed version of a stage musical. In the sense that there wasn't anything really fantastic with the camera going on. I think if you're doing a musical, you need to do a little more.
Well, this also seems like from a time when crowd-pleasing movies were more likely to win Oscars, I would think, too.
Yeah, that never happens anymore, Green Book. But yeah, I don't know. Yeah, it's fine. It's fine. It's not as soul crushing as I expected it could be.
Yeah.
But it wasn't.
It's entertaining enough.
Yeah. Like it's okay.
If you're trying to avoid reading Oliver Twist for school, I'd say you'd be better off watching the David Lean version.
Just
not
watch
so
the David Lean
version.
It's shorter.
This Oliver is for people that like that story and are already familiar with it and want this big budget just blown out musical version of the
watch
story.
Watch the David Lean version. Seek out a few of the songs.
Yeah.
But you don't have to watch the video with the songs.
But if you really like the Oliver Twist story, then yes, check this out for sure. It's absolutely worth watching.
But now, Jason, normally at this time, we find out what we're going to do on the BFI Top 100 next week. But you are going off on a little vacation.
I am. I'm finally going to be able to go home to visit my family and my wife's family in Nova Scotia now that the pandemic is kind of simmering down and we're opening back up. So I'm going to be off for a couple weeks. But stay tuned. There'll be at least one mini episode and hopefully an episode of another podcast I've done with Brendan that you will also enjoy.
Yeah, that's what we're going to do next week. So next week, you are going to hear an episode of my other podcast, What Were They Thinking, that Jason was a guest on.
Mm-hmm.
We talk about Wild Mountain Thyme.
And if you haven't seen it, watch it.
Watch it, especially watch it for that ending. Baby.
Don't pay for it, but watch it.
Yeah, find a way.
Find a way.
I'm sure it's streaming somewhere.
Probably on TV somewhere.
Yeah.
Watch probably it on Showcase.
Yeah, check it out on CBC. But yeah, that's it. So next week will be that, and then the week after that we'll have a mini episode. We'll talk about something, and then after that we are going to do, and now for something completely similar,
the final run, I believe.
The final run, just a short little run.
Yeah,
we're going to talk about some sequels, remakes, readaptations, etc., of some of the movies we've talked about so far, and we won't get into what those are right now.
We will tell you soon, though.
We will tell you after the mini episode. We'll announce the first one. But yeah, so that's it. Take a little breather, and we'll see you guys next week. But until then, Jason, they can find us on Facebook. Just search for Screen.
And Gundre.
Find us on Twitter at BFI_pod. They can find Jason on Twitter.
At Jason D. McLeod. That's MacLeod. Say hi. Just say hi.
And, of course, you can find us on TikTok. Just search for Screen.
And Gundre. We're over there. There's videos there, I swear.
There's a couple. So next week, enjoy a rerun, or I guess if you don't listen to my other podcast, not a rerun. It's brand new to you.
Brand new to you.
And then we'll do a mini episode, and then we'll launch into a little mini series. But so I just have to say to you, Jason, God save the Queen.
God save the Screen.
And for Screening Country, I'm Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
Toodles.
Bye-bye. I have to pee real bad. Bye.